हेलो फ्रेंड्स, वेलकम बैक। दिस इज हिमांशु वर्मा एंड इन दिस वीडियो वी विल स्टडी सेमीकंडक्टर्स एंड होल इफेक्ट। सेमीकंडक्टर्स आर दोज मटेरियल्स व्हिच हैव कंटिन्यूटी मोर देन इंसुलेटर्स एंड लेस देन मेटल्स। वन मोर थिंग अबाउट सेमीकंडक्टर्स इज द कंडक्टिविटी ऑफ सेमीकंडक्टर्स कैन बी मॉडिफाइड बाय एडिंग इम्प्योरिटीज इन द सेमीकंडक्टर एंड दिस इज द मेन रीजन व्हाई सेमीकंडक्टर्स आर मोस्टली यूज्ड इन इलेक्ट्रॉनिक्स इक्विपमेंट। इफ वी रिमाइंड आवर फर्स्ट लेक्चर केमिकल बॉन्डिंग, देन वी नो एन एटम हैज शेल्स, सबशेल्स एंड ऑर्बिटल्स एंड वी नो इन ऑर्बिटल्स इलेक्ट्रॉन्स स्टे। व्हेन एन सच एटम्स ऑफ अ मटेरियल कम क्लोजर, देन ड्यू टू म्यूचुअल इंटरेक्शन सम ऑर्बिटल्स स्टार्ट फिलिंग विद इलेक्ट्रॉन्स कम्प्लीटली। दे आर जनरली ऑर्बिटल्स ऑफ इनर शेल्स एंड सम ऑर्बिटल्स ऑफ आउटर शेल्स रिमेन वैकेंट। इफ एनी इलेक्ट्रॉन प्रेजेंट इन द ऑर्बिटल्स ऑफ आउटर शेल्स, देन इट विल बी फ्री टू मूव। इन दिस मैकेनिज्म नाउ ईच ऑर्बिटल इज कॉरस्पॉन्ड टू एन एनर्जी स्टेट एंड ग्रुप ऑफ दीज स्टेट्स इज नोन एज बैंड्स। सो नाउ इंस्टेड ऑफ यूजिंग वर्ड ऑर्बिटल्स वी विल यूज वर्ड स्टेट्स। Here in this diagram, these are four states which are completely filled with electrons and the group of these states is known as energy band, and because in this energy band all states are completely filled with electrons and those electrons are not able to move freely, so this band is known as valence band. Similarly, in this structure all states are empty, but if anyhow electron is present in any of the states, then that electron will be free to move and hence can conduct electricity. That's why the energy band forms by the combinations of these states is known as conduction band, because electrons in this band are free to move. If any material has this situation where valence band is completely filled and conduction band is completely empty, that is the situation of a insulator, because there is no free electrons in conduction band to move. Generally what happens, due to rise in temperature some electrons in valence band gain energy and excited into conduction band. Now how much energy that particular electron needs to get excited from valence band to conduction band will depend upon this energy band gap. This energy band gap is denoted by Eg, and if its value is large, then high energy will be required for electrons to excite from valence band to conduction band, and if Eg is small, then electron can easily excited from valence band to conduction band. So the width of this energy band gap will decide a material will be metal, insulator or semiconductor. In case of metals, there is no energy band gap at room temperature. In semiconductors, the energy band gap is less than 2 electron volt. But in case of insulators, the energy band gap is more than 5 electron volt. In case of semiconductors, even at room temperature, electrons receive that much energy which is greater than energy band gap. And that's why electrons move from valence band to conduction band. When an electron moves from valence band, then it leaves a empty state here, and that empty state is known as hole. So in case of intrinsic semiconductor, intrinsic means pure semiconductor, the number of electrons which are present in conduction band will leave same number of holes in valence band, and therefore in intrinsic semiconductor number of electrons and number of holes are always same. Also we should remember one thing, the energy corresponding to higher filled state at 0 Kelvin is known as Fermi energy level, which is denoted by EF. Remember, Fermi energy level in case of intrinsic semiconductor lies in between the conduction band and valence band. But in case of extrinsic semiconductor, if semiconductor is p-type, then it lies near the valence band, and if semiconductor is n-type, then it lies closer to the conduction band. Extrinsic semiconductors are those semiconductors in which we add some impurity deliberately. We do this to increase the conductivity of the semiconductor, because the impurity which we add is either trivalent or pentavalent. Mostly used semiconductors are silicon and germanium. Both silicon and germanium have 4 electrons in their valence shell. If we add a trivalent impurity, for example aluminium, which has 3 electrons in its valence shell, then there will be deficiency of 1 electron in bonding process. That deficiency will act as a hole, and that hole will attract the electron to fill this deficiency. And if this deficiency is filled, then at some other place a new deficiency will be created, or we can say a new hole will be created. In this way, the one hole which was present at this place, after some time that hole will present at some other place, because this hole deficiency is filled by a electron which created a deficiency at some other place. In this way we can say hole has been moved, means holes has been moved from this position to other position, but actually the movement of electrons has been occurred which filled this hole. But because now hole position has been changed, that's why we can also say hole has been moved. If we add a semiconductor with this type of impurity, means trivalent impurity, then a number of holes will be created in the semiconductor, and these holes are ready to move. Now this type of semiconductor is known as p-type semiconductor. And in this semiconductor, current carriers are holes, or we can say majority current carriers are holes and minority current carriers are electrons. Similarly, if we add pentavalent impurity, which has 5 electrons in its valence shell, then one electron will be extra, and that electron is free to move if some electric field is applied across the semiconductor. In this case, when pentavalent impurity is added, electrons are majority carrier, and this is known as n-type semiconductor. So in case of p-type semiconductor, holes are majority carrier and Fermi energy level will exist near to the valence band, and in case of n-type semiconductor, electrons are majority carrier and Fermi energy level will be closer to the conduction band, and in case of intrinsic semiconductor, the Fermi energy level will be in between the valence band and conduction band. If we look at the energy band gap of some semiconductors, then for silicon it is 1.1 electron volt, for germanium it is 0.7 electron volt, for gallium arsenide it is 1.42 electron volt. These values are at room temperature. Room temperature means 25 degree centigrade or 298 degree Kelvin. Sometimes we take room temperature at 300 degree Kelvin. Also, if we talk about mobility, then mobility is the drift velocity per unit electric field. Now mobility of holes is less than mobility of electrons, because in case of holes mobility, the one electron has to come from covalent bond, and now it fills the deficiency of electron. The electron to come from covalent bond takes more energy, and that's why we can say it is less mobile. But in case of n-type semiconductor, that electron is free to move, so this electron mobility is high. Therefore, we should always remember the mobility of electrons is always greater than mobility of holes. If we talk about conductivity of a material, then we know conductivity is equal to availability into mobility. Availability of what? Availability of charge per unit volume. In case of semiconductors, both electrons and holes are responsible for carrying the current. That's why conductivity will also depend upon the number of holes and electrons both. Conductivity for a semiconductor is equal to Ne, which is the charge per unit volume due to electrons, into mobility of electrons, plus Pe, which is the free charge due to holes, into mu h, which is the mobility of holes. Here N is the electrons concentration, means number of electrons per unit volume, and P is the holes concentration, means number of holes per unit volume. And mod of E shows electronic charge, which is equal to 1.6 into 10 raised to power minus 19 coulomb. CdS cadmium sulfide, InSb means indium antimonide, and ZnTe. These three materials have high carrier mobility. Now after studying some basics of semiconductor, we start new topic, which is Hall effect. The main advantage of Hall effect is that by using this effect, we can find whether a semiconductor is p-type or n-type. To perform this experiment, we take a semiconductor material which we don't know whether it is p-type or n-type. The semiconductor is in the form of cuboid, whose length is L, width is W, and height or depth is D. Now we apply a battery across the length of this semiconductor. If this side of semiconductor is contact with positive terminal of the battery and this side of semiconductor is contact with negative terminal of the battery, then a current will flow in this direction. Now if we apply a magnetic field in the direction of width of the semiconductor, obviously that magnetic field will be perpendicular to the direction of current, because current is flowing along the length of the semiconductor. If we draw a coordinate system, then suppose current is flowing in y direction and magnetic field is applied in negative x direction. Then x axis will be this, y axis will be this, and if we take right hand thumb rule, then x cross y will give the direction of z, which will be upward. I again remind, in this case the current is flowing in y direction and magnetic field is applied in negative x direction. Current is flowing along the length of the semiconductor and magnetic field is applied along the width of the semiconductor. Because the material is a semiconductor, it will contain both holes and electrons. We take holes as positive charge, that's why they must be moving along the y-axis, means in the direction of current, and electrons will be moving opposite to the direction of current, means in the negative y direction. Because we have applied a magnetic field which is perpendicular to the movement of these charge carriers, electrons and holes, so by Lorentz equation, these charge carriers, electrons and holes will experience a force which will be perpendicular to the movement of these charge carriers and the direction of magnetic field. The exact formula for force calculation is F is equal to Q into V cross B. So force on charge particle will be in the direction of V cross B. Now if we take the case of hole, which is a positive charge particle, then its velocity is in this direction and magnetic field is in this direction. So if we take V cross B, means we curl the finger from V to B, then thumb will give the direction of V cross B, and in this case it is pointing upward, means in z direction. So holes will experience a force towards z direction, means upward, means towards the upper face of this semiconductor. If we talk about electrons, then electrons has their velocity opposite to the velocity of holes, and also they have charge which is opposite to the charge of holes. Therefore for electrons, Q is negative and velocity is also negative, and minus minus becomes plus. So no change in the direction of force for electrons, means electrons will experience a force in the same direction as the force was experienced by the holes. In simple words, we can say in hole experiment, the electrons and holes will experience a force in same direction. Now if the semiconductor is p-type, then holes will be majority carriers and electrons will be minority carriers. Both electrons and holes will move upward. Due to majority of holes, this upper face becomes positive. And if we put a voltmeter across the depth of the semiconductor and connecting the upper surface with positive terminal of the voltmeter, then voltmeter will give a positive deflection. In the same arrangement, if we replace p-type semiconductor with n-type semiconductor, now again electrons and holes will experience a force upward direction. But due to majority of electrons, now upper surface will be dominated by electrons, means by negative charge. And now the deflection shown by this voltmeter will be negative. Hence we can say, if this voltmeter shows positive reading, then the semiconductor is p-type. And if this voltmeter shows negative reading, then the semiconductor is n-type. The voltage shown by this voltmeter is known as hole voltage. So hole voltage will be positive for p-type semiconductor and negative for n-type semiconductor. What happens if this semiconductor is intrinsic semiconductor? In that case, number of electrons and number of holes are same. Both will experience a force in upward direction, but due to same number of electrons and holes, there will be no resultant charge on the upper surface of semiconductor. Therefore, voltage shows zero deflection. But this is the ideal situation, because practically we know electrons' mobility is higher than holes' mobility. Due to higher mobility of electrons, they will dominate on the upper surface. So voltmeter reading will be slightly negative. So in exam, if this question is asked, what is the hole voltage in case of intrinsic semiconductor, then we will look at the options. If in options 0 volt is present, then we will mark 0, and if 0 volt is not present, then we will mark negative voltage. This force experienced by electrons and holes is known as Lorentz force, therefore denoted by FL. Now if we want to find the expression for hole voltage, then we should understand, in this case electrons and holes are experiencing Lorentz force which is in upward direction, but due to movement of charges in upward direction, there is a accumulation of positive charge or negative charge on the upper surface, which will create its own electric field. And after a certain accumulation, no more accumulation is possible further, because now their own electric field becomes so strong that it will overcome the Lorentz force and a equilibrium situation will exist. The electric field due to hole voltage will be equal to VH upon D because this VH voltage is across the depth T. We mark this electric field as EH, which is equal to VH upon D, and force will be equal to electric field into charge. So it is equal to VH upon D into me Q. Now in equilibrium condition, whole force is equal to Lorentz force, means Q into EH is equal to Q into VD into B. Here we didn't use cross sign because the angle between velocity and magnetic field is 90 degree. Now Q and Q cancel out and EH is VH upon D is equal to VD into B. From here VH is equal to VD into B into D. Now we want to bring either current or current density at the place of drift velocity because drift velocity is directly related to current. For this we know this expression, J is equal to sigma E. Now sigma is equal to availability into mobility. Availability means N into Q, charge per unit volume, into mobility into electric field. N into Q means charge per unit volume can be known as volume charge density and it can be represented by rho, and mu into E is drift velocity because mobility is the drift velocity per unit electric field. So from here J is equal to volume charge density rho into VD, and from here VD is equal to J upon me rho. If we replace it here then it becomes VH is equal to J upon rho into BD. Now J is the current density, means current per unit cross sectional area. Here cross sectional area is W into D, so at the place of J we can write I upon WD into me BD divided by volume charge density rho. D and D cancel out, so it becomes whole voltage VH is equal to BI upon rho into W. This expression is very important because this expression tells us applications of Hall effect. By seeing VH value in voltmeter, we can see the semiconductor is P-type or N-type, whether VH is positive or negative respectively. Also, we know the value of applied magnetic field. We know the value of current, which can be easily measured by putting an ammeter in series with semiconductor. Also, we know the width of the semiconductor and we know the hole voltage also. By using these parameters, we can found value of rho, which is the volume charge density, and rho is either equal to N into Q if semiconductor is N-type, or it is P into Q if semiconductor is P-type. So we can know the value of N or P also. So we can find the majority charge concentration by using Hall effect. Also if we see this expression, then at the place of VD means drift velocity, we can write mu into E. Here E is the electric field which is due to applied voltage, which is a source for current I, and its value will be equal to V upon L. L is the length of the semiconductor. So here we can find V, we can find E, which is equal to applied voltage upon me L. We know value of magnetic field intensity and depth of the semiconductor. Therefore, we can find mobility of the majority charge carrier in the semiconductor. So always remember, by using Hall effect, we can find electrons or holes concentration, means majority charge concentration. We can find magnetic flux intensity. We can find mobility. We can find whether semiconductor is P-type or N-type, means sign of charge carrier. But by using Hall effect, we cannot find diffusion constant, which is dN or dP. However, diffusion constant is equal to mobility into me VT. VT is the thermal voltage. But for the finding of thermal voltage, we require temperature, which we don't know. So diffusion constant cannot be calculated by using Hall effect experiment. Now we define one more parameter, which is Hall coefficient, denoted by RH. RH is equal to P into mu P square minus N into Q n square divided by charge, or we can say electronic charge, means mode of E, into P into mu P plus N mu N ka whole of square. If material is P type, then holes will be majority carriers and P into mu P will be very very greater than N into mu N. If we neglect N into mu N, then value of RH comes out positive and equal to 1 upon P into charge, and P is the number of holes per unit volume multiplied by charge will give volume charge density, which can be represented by rho. So RH is equal to 1 by rho, and it will be positive in case of p-type semiconductor. And obviously rho is the volume charge density due to holes. For n-type semiconductors, electrons will be majority carriers, means n into mu n will be greater than p into mu p. And after substituting this assumption, we find RH is negative, because now n into mu n is greater than p into mu p. And by solving further, it give RH is equal to 1 upon n into charge, which is again equal to 1 upon rho. Here rho is the volume charge density due to electrons. For intrinsic semiconductors, holes and electrons will be same, means n is equal to p is equal to ni. And if we assume holes mobility is equal to electrons mobility, then RH becomes 0. But if we assume holes mobility is less than electrons mobility, then RH comes out negative. Here also we will prefer 0, but if 0 is not given in the options, then we will mark negative. By looking at these three conditions, we can generalize a formula for RH, which is equal to inverse of the volume charge density, means RH is equal to 1 by rho. So we can write whole voltage expression VH is equal to RH into BI upon W, where RH is the hole coefficient. Here in the expression of VH, we should take care one thing. In the denominator, that side length will come along with magnetic field is applied. In our case, we applied magnetic field along the width of the semiconductor. That's why here W is come. If we had applied magnetic field along the depth of the semiconductor, then D would have come here. If we talk about metals, in metals electrons concentration is very very large. So volume charge density will be very very large, or we can say volume charge density is infinite. So hole coefficient will be equal to 1 upon infinite, which is equal to 0. And same, if we assume electrons mobility is greater than holes mobility, then here also it will be slightly negative. So we can conclude, if hole coefficient is positive, then current is due to positive charge carriers, means due to holes. If hole coefficient is negative, then current is due to negative charge carriers, means due to electrons. For metals, hole coefficient is 0 or negative. For metals, hole voltage is in microvolt and negative. For extrinsic semiconductor, hole coefficient is positive for p-type and negative for n-type. And hole voltage will come in millivolt. Voltage will be positive for p-type and negative for n-type. For intrinsic semiconductor, it is 0 or negative. For intrinsic semiconductor, hole voltage is also equal to 0 or negative. For insulators, RH and VH both are 0. After doing all this, now we look at one more new term, which is hole angle. Again, suppose this is the semiconductor and this is the applied electric field, which is due to applied voltage, and this is the hole electric field, which is due to accumulation of charges. Here we assume n-type semiconductor. That's why upper surface will act as negative charge and lower surface will act as positive charge, and a electric field from lower surface to upper surface will exist, which is denoted by EH. Now the resultant of these two electric field will be in this direction, and the angle made by this resultant electric field with applied electric field is known as hole angle. Now we can define tangent of this hole angle. Tan of theta H is equal to EH upon E, which is perpendicular upon base. Hole electric field is equal to hole voltage divided by D, and E is equal to J upon sigma. VH is equal to BI upon rho W, D as it is. Sigma is equal to rho into mu n, and J is equal to I upon me cross sectional area, which is DW. If we solve it, then we get B into mu n. So tangent of theta H is equal to B into mu n, and theta H is equal to tan inverse B into mu n, which is the expression for hole angle. Friends, some semiconductor devices like diodes, BJT, MOSFET, etc. we do not discuss here. We will discuss all these topics when we cover subject electronic device and circuit. Friends, we stop here. In the next video, we will start new chapter. See you in next video. Goodbye.